Welcome to the Virtual Memories Show. I'm your host, Gil Roth, and you're listening to a weekly podcast about books and life, not necessarily in that order. You can subscribe to the Virtual Memories Show on iTunes, or use our RSS feed with your favorite podcatcher. You can find the RSS feed on our websites, vmspod.com or chimeraobscura.com/vm. We're also on Twitter at vmspod, on Facebook at facebook.com/virtualmemoriesshow, and on Tumblr at virtualmemoriespodcast.tumblr.com. You can support this podcast and get access to exclusive content with a recurring monthly donation via Patreon. Just visit patreon.com/vmspod and set up your level of support. Every week you'll get new material from our patron-only blog, and you'll also get to listen to my monthly bonus podcast, Fear of a Square Planet, which features extra material from our guests and is only available to supporters of the show. So visit patreon.com/vmspod and patronize me. All right, I am back from Barcelona. I was there last week on a business trip. It was pretty exhausting, but I got great, great results out of it. Nothing for the podcast. But I scored this major win for my industry. This is all day job stuff. This major win for my industry in the big negotiation I was involved in. And now that the news about it is coming out, the companies that were exhibiting at the show were basically ready to pick me up and carry me around the exhibit hall. One guy, when I visited his stand, even, you know, came up to me and started sizing up the shoulders of my suit. And he said, "I'm measuring you for the statues of you we're going to build outside each of our manufacturing sites," which I took as a compliment. You might still want him to join the association and pay his $15,000 in dues, but, you know, a statue's a nice start, I guess. Anyway, so that was the day job. I got to see a little of Barcelona, not enough. Took some pictures, which I will post and link within the email that I send out for this show. But that's the way business stuff works. You always want to see more of the cities, and you always spend more time getting to and from the exhibit hall, I guess. Now, this coming week's also going to be nuts. There's Yom Kippur midweek. Easy fast to all of you who are observing. I got congressional briefings Friday for the day job stuff, and then I'm off to Columbus, Ohio for the second annual Cartoon Crossroads Columbus Festival, where I'm going to be a media guest. I was going to go Thursday, but because of this congressional stuff, my time at the festival is going to be kind of limited. But I am planning to come back with some good podcasts for you guys. That's sort of why I do this stuff, and I'm certainly not going to get them out of talking to congressional aides. So, now this week's guest comes from another cartooning festival I went to, the Small Press Expo in Bethesda, Maryland, last September. The guest this time around is Glen Baxter. Now, Glen has a new book out called Almost Completely Baxter, New and Selected Blurtings. It's from New York Review of Comics. Glen is a very strange artist. He's not a cartoonist exactly. His work is pretty indescribable, but hilarious. On the face of it, Glen does these single panels of semi-real, semi-absurd drawings, usually kind of pulp-influenced with jungle explorers and cowboys and other stuff. And they've got these really not quite non sequitur, but really nutty captions that go with them. They're tough to explain or describe without seeing them. He has this great line style that's almost like a woodcut thing going on. If you saw one, you'd say, "Oh, that guy." So, but here's actually, let me read you how his publisher, New York Review Comics, describes it. Over four decades and a multitude of books, quote-unquote Colonel Glen Baxter has built a world and a language all his own. Slightly familiar, decidedly abnormal, irresistibly funny. Have you felt the terror of a failed Szechuan dinner? Have you seen what happens at precisely 6:15? Do you know where the beards are stored? Either way, this is the book for you. Baxter's drawings are a delicious stew of pulp adventure novels, highbrow hijinks, and outright absurdity. Lonesome cowboys confront the latest in modern art. Brave men tremble before Moussaka. Schoolgirls hoard hashish, and the world's fruits are in constant peril. Wimples abound. So I hope that gives you some flavor for this. The new collection, Almost Completely Baxter, is hysterical and weird. And when I started researching for this episode, I was kind of amazed to find that Glen Baxter is in his 70s, and he's been doing this sort of work for decades now. It's a style that can be knocked off, and has, and we talk about that during the show, about how he built such a unique style or unique approach to his art, but one that can also get ripped off. Anyway, here's his bio. There's a whole lot of weird conversation that's about to ensue, but here's the bio from the new book. Glen Baxter is the author of many books since the 1970s, including The Impending Gleam, The Billiard Table Murders, and Blizzards of Tweed. His work has appeared in The New Yorker, Vanity Fair, Elle, Vogue, Le Monde, The Observer, and The Independent on Sunday. He is a Chevalier of the Order of Arts and Letters, and his art is often exhibited in New York, Amsterdam, Paris, and London, where Colonel Baxter lives. Colonel is in quotes. That's part of his shtick. I was going to start this whole podcast with, "So, Colonel, tell me where it all began." But, of course, I screwed up when we actually started. And now, the Virtual Memories Conversation with Glen Baxter. The first thing I wanted to ask you, actually, having seen your things individually over the years and now seeing a single collection of stuff, because in America we don't have your longer form, at least I can't get a hold of your longer books, does your work practice consist of fracturing the universe first, or do you, like, does something absurd in the universe jump out at you, and you know, where does it all come from?
I think the universe arrives fractured.
Yeah.
To me, I don't have to do anything. It's reportage, basically.
Mm-hmm. Your history with the absurd. Where does the surrealist absurd nature first of the verbal component of your drawings, and then the visual side of things. Do you have strong influences or precursors or ways of framing, like, how you got to where you got?
Well, there was a couple of things, yeah. When I was a kid at nursery school, I used to go there every day. Both my parents were working, so I was there every day. And there was an open day at the nursery, and my parents came along, and there were three trestle tables filled with little models that the children had made. So my mother said to the teacher, they said, "Oh, which models did our Glen make?" And she said, "Oh, those two tables." So this was a warning bell already chiming loud and clear. And the other thing was that when I was young, I had a stammer, and I couldn't speak very, very well. And my mother sent me on an errand to buy a collar stud for my father's shirt, you know, the collarless, you know, shirt type. Sounds incredibly old-fashioned now, to the haberdashery shop. And so I was so nervous and terrified that I went down the road rehearsing the lines in my head all the way down there, so that hopefully when I got into the store, I could actually speak without getting stuck and, you know, stammering. And so I was rehearsing and rehearsing and rehearsing, and I got to the store, went in there, up to the counter, and a man behind the counter with rimless glasses looked at me and said, "Yes." And I said, "Do you have any collar studs, please?" "Perfectly." And then he said to me, "I'm afraid not. But if you try the haberdashery shop next door, maybe they might be able to help you." And so I turned somewhat perplexed and realized that I was in a furniture shop. And my panic had driven me into the wrong place. So it was the right speech in the wrong place, you know. And then years later, when I went to art school, I was reading about André Breton on the Surrealists. And I realized then that I was actually a proto-surrealist. I was already there in this enchanted domain of, mm-hmm. you know, fractured reality that already existed for me.
The intuitively absurd?
Yeah.
Would that be?
Yeah, absolutely.
how did the art, the visual side of the art, really take off for you? How did you develop it, I guess, is a better way of putting it.
Well, I went to art school when I was 16 and expecting a kind of fantastic world of La Vie Boheme, you know.
Yeah.
And it was terrible. It was very...
trade-oriented? Or
no, it was very structured. And everyone was obsessed with American abstract expressionism. Mm. And I couldn't see the point in doing a kind of a pastiche of American painting. I wanted something that was kind of more English, you know. And something strange happened. I came across the work of Max Ernst. And I discovered his collage novels. And the idea of cutting things out and making these bizarre, these haunting, absurd, nightmarish even, some of them, images based on found material was exactly what I kind of, I felt I should be doing something like that. But I didn't want to slavishly copy Max Ernst. But the spirit of that made me think long and hard about the direction I wanted to take. And that direction led me to the French surrealists. Dada and surrealism were my heroes when I was at school. Against the run of the mill, you know, it was all abstraction. But for me, it was Dada and surrealists was where it was happening. And I discovered that a lot of the influences had gone to America, especially New York. Marcel Duchamp came to New York. And a lot of American poets that translated French surrealist poetry, John Ashbery and Harry Matthews and Ron Padgett, and I found a connection between works, say, like Frank O'Hara, who worked at the Museum of Modern Art and wrote poems in his lunch hour. And I found a kind of like a breath of fresh air for me. And so I was kind of, I realized that things had switched to America, and I was just curious about all that. And eventually I got to America. I came in 1974 to read my rather terrible prose poems at St. Mark's Church in the Bowery. And I stood up at the lectern in a tweed suit and started reading, and the audience just fell about laughing. And
was it funny to you at the time?
It was good.
Did you intend it to be funny? I guess.
I was getting a response. Yeah. In England, people had just fallen asleep or left.
Oh, I just mean, were you hoping somebody would laugh, or was it, but this is serious, you know?
It was that kind of, it's that wonderful French word, the frisson, you know, where you're not quite sure what's going on.
Yeah.
And then in that moment, kind of this bolt of lightning strikes. And that happened to me there, you know, and that was perfect.
Mm-hmm. Did you come back to New York relatively often?
I did, yeah. It was my only audience in the early days, because people had no time for me in England and weren't interested in what I was doing, and so New York was the audience. Although, I mean, in St. Mark's Church, the audience were poets and filmmakers and writers.
It's a very specific New
York. Yeah, I wasn't dealing to the mass of American.
It's the Ohio audience or something.
But it was it gave me sustenance to keep on, and it kind of affirmed what I suspected, you know, that the world is a mad place and New York is a good place to be mad in, you know.
That's a good way of putting it. Do you get back at all in recent years?
Less and less. I mean,
you're headed to Brooklyn tomorrow, but you know,
yeah,
that's a different New York.
I used to come quite a lot, and then what happened was that I got recognized in England and France too. So I spent a lot of time then, concentrating on the European side of it. Really, it was kind of strange, but it was America that gave me the first push.
Mm-hmm. What do you think accounted for the lack of I guess that sort of artistic development in the UK? Was it any sort of post-war, still rebuilding? You know, we don't have time for frivolousness, or did you ever, you know, kind of contemplate what it was that was lacking, I guess? What you needed in the US, was there anything that accounted for its absence?
I thought it was kind of blindness. I thought the English just couldn't see what was happening. I remember I went to the cinema, and in those days you could walk into the where the films were already running, so you'd come in halfway through, fractured narrative time again, you know. And you'd see some cowboy or some strange film. One of the films I saw was a black and white film shot in New York. A guy with a belted raincoat and funny hairdo and a little hat was leaning up against a wall, and a New York cop comes by swilling his billy club and says to him, "Come on, Buster, move along. What do you think you're doing holding up the building?" You know. So the culprit then walks away and the building falls down. It was Harpo Marx, you know. And so I thought, hang on, this is something terrific, you know. And why doesn't anybody pick up on this? And I was watching Busby Berkeley films, Dames. Mm-hmm. And my mother said, "Oh, they're just Hollywood musicals." And I said, "No, they're not. It's this surrealism, you know, by another name." So I was putting all these connections together, which seemed to have bypassed a lot of people in England. And I was creating this little world, which seemed to make sense to me, but to nobody else.
I'm going
to
make some sort of Busby Berkeley versus Bishop Barclay thing about the British being much more pragmatic, I guess, and not surrealist. Feel free to steal that at any point, and just give me a little credit in a panel if you ever use it. Because I wonder if there was a certain cultural mindset, I guess, that just, you know, was a blind spot as far as what you were developing. Because we see, I mean, there's a British comedy tradition, a number of comedy traditions, but from the 60s into the 70s, I think you do see a little more of the Python-esque thing where you get absurdity.
It happened in radio and television, but it didn't happen in art, you know. And so I was working in a field where it was very, very po-faced, you know, and very solemn. And people, you know, just didn't seem to... They didn't take Dada on surrealism seriously, you know, where I did. To me, it was kind of a life force, you know. And surrealism existed not only in painting and sculpture, but in films and in poetry, you know, literature. And so it was a spirit, you know, the spirit of surrealism is what I was intrigued by. And
how does it influence your worldview outside of art? What does it mean to you? I guess Dada and the surreal. How does that inform how you see things, I suppose?
Well,
won't know because you only see it your way, but still, you know.
Visiting a country where Donald Trump could possibly be president.
Well, that was my next question. Is the world more absurd or less absurd than when you started?
I think he's ratcheted up a few notches.
Yeah. Is there that sense that it's just at least helping you cope with the absurdity of our day-to-day life?
Oh, absolutely, totally, yeah. It's sort of, it reassures me that I'm on the right track.
Were you prepared for Brexit, for what happened?
Absolutely, totally astonished. Yeah. I couldn't believe that it was going to happen, because the main protagonists were such nitwits, you know, Nigel Farage and Boris Johnson and Michael Gove, you know, these nonsensical twits, you know.
Which, again, you couldn't have done a panel about and yeah.
Yeah. And so, I mean, especially I have a lot of friends and I work a lot in France. And the European cultural thing is very important to me. And the idea of having that snatched away. In fact, nobody talked about culture in any of the debates, you know.
That is of a piece with what we have in America.
Yeah.
That's something for highbrows and the elite, as it were. And we're not supposed to talk about, you know, the meaning of art and actually caring about, you know, our accomplishments as a civilization.
Yeah.
Instead, it's me. And the sense of everybody being treated as a transactional unit of capital as opposed to, you know, a human being, I guess. So that sucks. do you think it's actually ever going to come off?
Well,
and again, this is getting into a politics discussion that I don't normally do.
I would hope not, but I don't know how the mechanism works. All I know is that it's going to take years for the lawyers to rewrite all the laws. It seems just like a tremendous waste of money, basically, you know, and time to get us back to where, you know, to somewhere similar where we used to be. And also, behind it all is this terrible nagging thing about nationalism. That's the shadow that falls over all of this. Mm-hmm. And simmering underneath all this is a level of neo-fascism, you know, which rose to the surface after the Brexit. A lot of Polish people, a lot of Hungarian people who lived in England all their lives, worked, were regular citizens, were being abused by these nitwits who they thought they'd been given carte blanche to, speak up and tell them to go back to their own country, you know. I hate all that. It's terrible.
What were your parents like?
My parents, my dad was a welder in a steel factory. And my mother was just a mom, you know, just looking after her.
Housewife.
Housewife, yeah.
Yeah, I know, terrible term, but that's...
Yeah, her three kids. Mm-hmm.
Do they get what you did artistically?
Eventually they did, yeah.
Were they able to appreciate the success you achieved?
Oh, they were, yeah, okay. Yeah. Well, this is after the war, and my dad was working all hours that God sent to make some money so that his children could get a better life and not be doing what he was doing. So they were very encouraging to us to get an education, you know. Yeah. We didn't have any books in our house. We used to go to the library, but they were keen that we should, as they say in England, get on, you know, and do something. And I think that the turning point happened when my father, who was a welder in the factory, one of the men at his work, who was the blue collar guy in the office, said to him, "Oh," he said, "you must be proud of your son," you know. He said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, he's got this book out, you know, and he's actually a genius, your son." And so my father came home and said, "Yeah, I think, you know, might be onto something, yeah, you know." Because I remember once he came down to see me in London, and then he went back to Leeds. And then I rang him up and said, "Oh, Dad, I'm going to New York in a couple of weeks' time." And he said, "New York?" And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "What are you going there for?" Good question, actually. And so I said, "I've got an exhibition, Dad." And he said...
You think you're a flasher?
No. He said, "Exhibition?" He said, "Of what?" And I said, "Have I got the right number here?" You know. And I said, "Do you know when he came to see me, you know, in our flat in London?"
Those canvases, all those...
Yeah, yeah. And I said, "Do you know those things on the wall?" And he said, long pause, and he said, "Oh, that stuff."
To be fair, my old man at my college graduation thought I had been studying marine biology. I was a literature guy. I was writing about Orwell's essay Inside the Whale, so that may have been where he picked it up, probably the closest connection he was going to make to anything I was up to. So. Who were you reading when you were a kid?
When I was a kid, I think I read every Biggles book going.
Yeah.
And all the adventure stories. And then... the cinema was a big influence.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we used to go to the cinema a lot, about three times a week, because they would change the
the programming.
The programming, yeah. And usually it was a technical main feature, preceded by a black and white cowboy. Always a black and white cowboy. Then there's a newsreel and a cartoon, I think. Yeah.
Is that where the cowboy thing started for you?
I'm sure that's where it happened, yeah.
Because it's one thing when American cartoonists focus on cowboys. It's another thing when Europeans do, because it's such a weird cultural thing for us. But I've always been curious about the...
Yeah, I mean, I think I was brainwashed, actually. Yeah. I think I was the Manchurian candidate, but I was living in Leeds at the time, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, what has London been... How has London changed for you over the time you've been there?
Money.
Yeah.
Money's changed everything.
And that's New York also.
Yeah, it's the same thing. I mean, all the things that made the cities great, all the cultural, you know, vibrancy has been made less possible by the fact that people can't afford to live there anymore, you know. Mm-hmm. And all the energy is kind of, is dissipated. It's the same in New York, exactly.
Yeah.
Manhattan. Who lives in Manhattan now? You know, nobody.
Yeah, it's just a tax haven for oligarchs.
Yeah.
It's just somewhere to park the money. And
same as London, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and is that has it remained affordable? Or are you living in an area that's still doable, or is it one of those things where the success you've had with...
Well, luckily, with the success that I did have, we managed to secure a modest cave in South London.
I've got a friend in Camden Town who has a 99-year lease, apparently, on a place. So, you know, if he lives too long, he's doomed. But otherwise, I think they'll make out okay on this. But it's a house that's from the 1840s or so, which is something we're just not accustomed to in America. That's
that's ancient history for you, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, we're very much of the now.
Yeah.
So, you know, what surprised you, I guess, or what was it about American culture that, besides what you were exposed to in the cinema, what was the juxtaposition of that and what you actually experienced coming over here? Do you remember?
Yeah, I came in 74, and I was absolutely amazed that it was so old-fashioned.
New York was a hole back then. But, you know, at least there were good art pockets. But
yeah, but I mean, all the buildings that I like were kind of in the 1930s, you know. And if you look across Manhattan now, the only interesting buildings, more or less, are the old buildings.
Yeah.
The modern buildings are just kind of faceless, you know. Yeah. But in those days, I was kind of amazed that it was like a, you know, an Art Deco place. And people were kind of courteous and polite and literate, you know. Well, I was moving in, obviously, in a sort of circle. Yeah. Gotham Bookmark. There were real bookstores there, you know. And I was amazed you could buy a book at midnight, you know.
Yeah, that's just one of the things I always loved with the 10:30, 11 o'clock. You know, I want to go over to Bookstore X and get something.
Yeah.
Or comic stores, which was my nerdish thing. Actually, let me ask. You consider your work art, not comics, or do you consider there to be a split between them? Particularly, and which scene is more depressing? I guess the art scene or the cartooning.
Well, they're both depressing.
I just wonder which one brings you down more.
So. Yeah, but I never thought that I did comics, because in England it's tricky, because if you say you're a cartoonist, people immediately assume that you're a political cartoonist. Mm-hmm. Or at least
here they assume you're a strip cartoonist, like a Sunday papers thing.
Like a bande dessinée thing, yeah. Yeah. So I didn't grow up with a background of that kind of attitude towards anything to do with the graphic arts. And it was the French who had that liberated field toward it, really. It was something like Daumier, you know. Is a fantastic figure who straddles all those worlds, and so I never thought of myself as being one or the other, and I kind of, in a way, I kind of blundered into what I do now via poetry, you know, scene, via interest in surrealism, and when I first read at St. Mark's Church, I had a few little drawings that I showed to Rudy Burkhart and to Ron Padgett, and they said, "Oh, we could get him an exhibition, you know, here." I was amazed. And so I kind of, what happened was that the drawings without texts sort of collided with the prose poetry and gave what you have today, I think, something like that happened, you know, there's a collision. Mm-hmm.
Do you write poetry nowadays? I know there's a couple of prose pieces in the new collection, but I'm not sure how old those are.
I know they're quite recent. Yeah, I still dabble in the dark arts. Yeah.
Yeah. Which poets do you follow nowadays? I know Ron Padgett was a big influence. As you
mentioned. Ron Padgett was a big influence. Larry Fagin, Clark Coolidge, John Ashbery. Of course, Frank O'Hara was kind of.
I only know one line of his, but I stole it from the guy who did the biography of Frank O'Hara, Brad Gooch, who was a guest on the show.
Yeah.
The only truth is face-to-face. I use that as the mission statement for this. It's why I don't do Skype interviews.
Yeah.
I only do face-to-face. I don't know anything else of O'Hara's work, unfortunately,
because
I'm a poetry imbecile, but, you know, you put up with me. So. But O'Hara was the big, sort of the you mentioned him in terms of being a sort of turning point for you.
Yeah, because I saw Frank O'Hara in a much the same way as Apollinaire was in Paris, mm-hmm. the poet amongst painters, and he was the kind of his kind of kingpin, his influence extended just beyond his poems, and I think his enthusiasm and general kind of joie de vivre was what was really impressive, and because he died tragically young, So, but his legacy lives on. And Ron Padgett's work is has that similar kind of serious humorous, you know, combination, which I really appreciate, with a kind of a view of the modern world that I respond to. Mm-hmm.
Do you see yourself fitting into any sort of scene, for lack of a better word? Is there a scene in which you travel in along those lines?
Yeah, I hate to be pigeonholed.
Yeah, that's why I figured it's kind of...
Yeah, because then you're stuck, you know, you can't get out of that thing. So it's better to be just blundering through all these fences, you know.
It's been working fine for me all these years. Had you thought at all about doing political work when you were starting out? You mentioned that, you know, cartooning equaled politics to, you know, yeah, the general audience. Had that been an interest of yours at any point? Or
no, never, no. And in fact, I thought, well, there were so many political cartoonists, and why join on the tailcoats of all that? Not that I was interested in it, but also the other thing is that politicians who are mocked by the political cartoonists, they buy the original artwork. You know,
so. Yeah, David Levine complained about that. Like LBJ, Lyndon Johnson wanted to buy something, and he was insulted that I criticized you with this. Why are you, you know, trying to give me money for it?
Yeah. So it's kind of strange, really.
You mentioned though the schism or lack thereof between art and comics. You've done a couple of sustained narratives, long form stuff, which unfortunately I haven't seen, because I can't find them in the U.S. Is that a challenge for you? Was it something you really wanted to take on, this idea of long form with fractured narrative, from what I gather, as opposed to working in the single panel model that you excel in?
In a way, it was like going back to the roots of the Max Ernst collage novels, mm-hmm, idea, and trying to create the excitement also that I had as a kid when you're reading something and you turn the page and something startling happens on the next page. So I tried to make a book where you'd be reading one thing, turning the page, and you'd be kind of wrong-footed on the next page.
Like there's a physical act of flipping
pages. Yeah, and so that was that was the kind of what I wanted to do. That was the key point, the page-turning aspect of it all. And then I got into the idea of having chapters and how that could be misleading or leading you onto something, and red herrings and all these kind of plot devices, which you could have fun with, you know. Given that it doesn't have to make sense anyway, you know, as long as you can get enough text and images in a confusing combination, so that people are.
I don't think that's how most people approach, you know, creating narrative form. But you know, if it works for you, that's
yeah. Great. I mean, I like to be amazed by paintings and by books, and quite often you're not, because you know the background where it's coming from, but it's kind of trying to go back to that first time that I ever saw a Giorgio de Curico painting, mm-hmm, and I thought, what is that? You know, I couldn't understand it at all, and I fell in love with it, and the whole idea of the mystery and the profundity of that picture is really had a real charge for me. And to this day, you know, I can go back and look at his work and still have that a resonance of that original feeling that I have. It's still there.
Do you appreciate primarily visual arts, paintings in particular, or are there other art forms that you... For the most part, I find contemporary art, like installation art, to be kind of bullshit in a lot of respects. Painting, I mean,
I like paintings by dead people.
Okay, that's what I was getting at. Do you have any affinity?
They have to be dead to be good, yeah, more or less, yeah.
Yeah, contemporary art, I'm kind of...
The thing is, when you can do anything that you like, it ends up being, you know...
Lifeless.
Yeah, boring, you know, lifeless and academic, you know. I went to the Whitney yesterday, and most of the things in the Whitney could actually be in Ripley's auditorium, you know.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, there's so much junk in there, you know.
I have a short story about an experience I had at the Art Institute of Chicago, where one of the big pieces of art was a fiberglass cast of a fallen tree. Yeah. And there's a whole story about the tree that actually fell and how the guy had to saw it and send it to Japan to get these fiberglass casts made, et cetera, and brought back. And now it's sitting in an art institute in Chicago. And I'm just, it's not art. And I'm sorry. I mean, I know it's to you it's art, but it's
I think Tom Wolfe lampooned all this in The Painted Word.
And the fact that people are still doing this decades later, you know, just sort of boggles my mind.
They are without shame.
I finally figured it out. Thank you. That explains how this keeps going. What have you improved at? What have you gotten better at visually or just with your
art? Oh.
Besides life in general.
Okay.
And your wife is sitting nearby. She can say, you have not improved in this at all.
I'm quite good at pétanque.
Yeah?
Yeah. And my ukulele playing is just getting off the ground a little bit.
One of the attendees who's going to be at the show today is a big ukulele jammer, a guy named Scott Edelman. I'll try and introduce you while you're here.
Okay.
Because he might have an extra ukulele with him in the car.
Okay.
If you wanted to have a little uke jam at SPX. So. But yeah, artistically, what else have you... what do you feel you do better now than you once...
I know I must be doing something okay because there's so many people who copy me, you know, in what I do. So many fake Baxters. So I think I must be on the...
What was that like? The first time you realized, Jesus, these people are knocking me off. Like, was that a compliment or a... Matt Groening once said, copyright infringement is the sincerest form of flattery. But, you know, I what was it like for you?
I prefer the check.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, what was that experience when you realized you were having... Your work was so distinctive that it could be a type of a sort?
It was annoying because I had so many years trying to get my work published and was turned down time and time again, and I had to go through all these hoops to actually get my work published and accepted. And then as soon as it's accepted and it's published, there's a whole host of people, you know, riding on your coattails and who are taking a shortcut, really, you know, and it is annoying, really. Mm-hmm. It's also flattering in a kind of way that Matt Groening mentioned. But at the end of the day, you know, it's your paycheck being sliced away, really.
Ever lead to any fistfights in galleries?
Sadly not, no.
Ah, damn it. Because my wife and I were leaving Orsay once and actually saw two painters get into a fight in the sidewalk and figured there had to be some artistic reason behind this. It was, you know, I figure, you know, if you were French, it would be more likely to happen. But improvements in technology impacted how you do what you do?
Not really. I mean, no.
You don't draw on a computer?
No. I work with pencils and ink on paper. And the only thing that the technology has made possible is that I can send a JPEG of it to anywhere in the world, rather than FedExing it off and taking, you know, there's...
The insurance and hoping to God it shows up.
Yeah. But that's all I use the computer for sending images. Because people want things tomorrow as well now, rather than like in 4 days' time. So that makes it easier.
Yeah. But there's been no sense of you haven't changed in those terms, in terms of how you make what you make?
No. In fact, the only thing is that all the books that I used to like when I was a kid, all the printed books were all printed on cheap paper using the lithographic process, and the inks would seep into the paper and give it like a soft glow, and this is the kind of effect that I try to get with my own work. And to do that, you have to use the most expensive watercolor paper known to man.
Just a fake cheap paper.
Yeah. So that's kind of wonderful that you have to spend a fortune to make it look cheap, you know.
And when you talk about the Baxter knockoffs side of things, are there positive influences you've seen? Artists you've inspired, but not in a knockoff sort of way?
Wow, that's a tricky question.
Do you look at anybody and say, wow, that's I could see where you developed from me, but you developed your own voice?
or is it, you know, is what you do so distinctive that it's really tough to pair off of that?
It's difficult because if it was too close for comfort, then of course you can never really, really like it. And to be quite honest, I don't really keep up much with what's going on in the real world.
Yeah.
I'm confined to my own little sphere. So I don't get out much, you know. That's probably a problem.
It's worked for you this far.
It has, yeah.
You know, outside of not expecting Brexit to happen. But, you know, otherwise it's... And I interviewed someone last week who, she's a 30-year-old journalist who said that, you know, we had no idea until we held like a town hall sort of meeting for young voters, you know, to ask questions. And every single one of them said they were going to vote exit. And that was, we did not expect that. And that might mean next week is not going to turn out the way we think it's going to turn out.
Yeah.
But that was pretty much the only indication they this little, you know, journalism thing had leading into it. So, and no one was going to listen to them. What size do you actually do these panels in? They're printed in a nicely compact book.
Yeah.
But I'm sort of imagining them a little more.
These expansive. The ones in the book are about this big, and then when I show in a gallery, the works are bigger because if you show works that size, they look like postage stamps in a gallery. So you have to work bigger, and also it gives me greater freedom, and I can work on the colors a lot more intensely. And I've done some really big, sort of 6-foot by 4-foot drawings.
Does anyone commission absurdity from you?
Commissioned. I was commissioned by Cartier to do. They did a book with they got 5 different artists to work on different chapters of a book about this special watch thing a few years ago, and I've been given carte blanche by Le Monde to do certain things and The Observer and. And when I used to work for the New Yorker, when Bob Gottlieb was the editor, then I lived in what I didn't realize was a golden age of sending drawings in and getting them all accepted. And
I just interviewed 2 New Yorker cartoonists yesterday, Michael Maslin and Liza Donnelly. We recorded last weekend, and they said it's a very different world.
Yeah, it is. Yeah,
than it once was. What was that experience like? How did you connect with the New Yorker to begin with?
Well, I was published. I was having no success at all, and then I had an exhibition in London at the ICA, and which was my first public exposure, rather than in a small private gallery. Mm-hmm. And I got a rave review in the English press, and I had Alfred Knopf, I had Jonathan Cape. And Thames and Hudson all banging on my door, and I couldn't understand what the difference between today and yesterday was. You know,
the difference.
Yeah. So I did. I was published. I did a best-selling book in England, and then Alfred Knopf did my first three books, and Gottlieb was the editor at Knopf in those days. Complete and utter fan. And then when he went to the New Yorker, he rang me up and said, "Oh, I'm the editor there, and I sent some work in," which I did do, and was published until he was forced out. He was forced out, basically, And then Tina Brown took over. Of course, as you know, is English, so that was the death knell for me, you know.
That she had no sense of humor for what she
was
doing.
She's English,
that's
right,
what I was going to ask, the Tina Brown transition. Yeah. That's funny. Oh, my God. Yeah, I just wondered, when I was interviewing Maslin, we talked about he did a book about Peter Arno, the great cartoonist. And I asked if his real attraction to Arno was that he longed for an era in which New Yorker cartoonists would steal women from Howard Hughes, get into fights with Vanderbilts, and, you know, show up with a gun at a party. And he said, it was a different world back then. You know, I do kind of look back fondly at that world where, you know, top hats, et cetera, but, you know, most cartoonists. Lives of quiet desperation, etc.
Exactly,
what are you? Well, is it fair to ask what are you working on, or are you working on what you've been working on for the last number of 60 decades, years. Is it part of the continuum? Or do you see your work progressing? Do you see your work at stages, I guess? And if so, you know, are you headed towards something at present? I know it's a weird question. As a non-artist, I can ask this in a completely blithe and stupid way. You know.
Well, I don't know. I've got an exhibition coming up in Paris in November. Mm-hmm. So I am working towards that. And I've got one in London next year. And also, I'm talking about doing a book about all the art drawings that I've ever done with my Dutch publisher.
You mean the art sort of panels?
Yeah.
Like the ones where, you know, the turns out there's a whole Mondrian heist going on?
All that thing, okay. Yeah. Unfortunately, there's rather a lot of Mondrian heists.
Yeah, but it makes such an obvious, not an obvious, such a good joke visually to
well, when you put a Mondrian in, most people, I think, I hope, in the civilized world can recognize it.
That's what I'm saying. It's a good signifier right there. Yeah, that, you know, yeah. A Klee. You know.
It's difficult, isn't it? Yeah, yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm.
But do you see the work? I guess it's a weird question. I don't want to make you doubt the entirety of your career. How has it changed? How have you...
It's got worse.
Yeah. Well, that's good to know. We can wrap up on that.
Yeah.
Yeah, how's the... When you look back at earlier work of yours, as you must have done to put this book together,
yeah,
you know, what do you see? What are the things that
where did I go wrong?
Are the things that made you cringe back then that you know, or are you pretty comfortable with the progress of, you know?
Actually, I feel pretty okay. There's a funny line. Ron Padgett wrote a book called Poems I Think I Wrote, where he looks back onto poems that he can't remember. Wow. Can't remember writing. And there's an element of that. Like, did I really do that? You know. And actually, generally, I'm not ashamed in any way. I'm a shameless person, you can say. Yeah.
Which again works perfectly fine, and as I think it puts you more in the comics world than art world at that point. But you know, that's still good. Are there any cartoonists you follow at all? I'm assuming not downstairs at SPX here, but are there? Do you have any affinity for that world?
I don't really know much about cartooning. I mean, the cartoons that I really liked were Charlie Adams.
Yeah?
Yeah, he really... when I saw Charlie Adams, I thought, well... I love the spirit of his work, you know. And he'd found a way of conveying that, the atmosphere in his pictures. And after he died, there's a lovely... They ran a great one in The New Yorker of... the view from a windshield of a car, and the car in front has got a notice in the back saying "honk if it's been driven by a moose," and it says "honk if you believe in reincarnation." And I thought his widow had got it out of the drawer, and I thought this is kind of spooky, double spooky, really, in a way, you know.
But you should be able to, especially for someone like him, there should be a death-oriented celebration.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
At the very end of it all.
And the other person who was kind of very influential in my early life was when I showed at the Gotham Bookmark, I met Edward Gorey, mm-hmm. who showed them a lot. And he was incredibly enthusiastic, encouraging me. And having his, you know, stamp of approval was kind of great. And he was the first artist who'd ever bought my work. Yeah. The first artist whose work also I really admired, and I could see what he was at. You know, Gorey's world is rather specific, but it's kind of an enchanting world, really, you know. Mm-hmm. So I was kind of thrilled to pieces when that happened, you know.
Have younger artists sought out your approval?
Yeah, many, yeah. People write to me, and people write PhDs and theses about, you know, about me. And I try and be generous with my time and try and advise them as best I can. Some of them are okay, yeah. Despite being young.
Yeah, see, that's what I'm saying. Anyone younger than you, they can't possibly
be. That's most of the known world at the moment, right?
Yeah, what's the biggest change from 1944 to now?
Moving from black and white into color.
Yeah.
Because our son thought that looking at all the old newsreels, he thought that the world actually was black and white. And in fact, in a way it was. because kind of austere, and there was, you know,
the bombing, or just the post-war.
Yeah, post-war, a depression, lack of food, and clothing was grey or dark grey. You had a choice, you know. But then sort of cranking up to sort of turbo-powered full colour. And also, when I first started out, I did black and white drawings because people couldn't afford to, I did colour drawings, but people couldn't afford to
reproduce.
And now it's the opposite. Now if you see a black and white drawing, it's like, hey, this is kind of, you know, throwback time. Like a black and white photograph, you know. Now everybody's, it's all colour, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you, any sort of the whole social media thing is, I mean, you've got a website up and a Tumblr, but I don't see you much as the guy posting pictures on Instagram, you know, trying to.
I do Instagram, yeah.
Oh, do you? Okay, shoot. Yeah. I got to look it up now.
My daughter told me to do it, and I obey my daughter. Because it's a good way of reaching out to people, you know. And
Do you find the audience renewing generationally?
Yeah, this is living proof, because I mean, some of these people weren't born when I was starting out.
1971, so I feel like a heel. But
So there is, I think that there is a new audience for it, and in a way, I mean, people think that I'm dead anyway, so it's true.
I figure the world's going to stay absurd. You're going to stay relevant.
Yeah, it's true. When my daughter was getting married, we had to go in to see the to fill the documentation in, and we sat down, and she said, name of bride, bride's father, and she said, Glen Baxter, and so the woman behind the desk said, Glen Baxter, I thought you were going to do something. And so then I realized then, you know.
So hold on. You'll be around a long, long time with this stuff. So Glen Baxter, thanks so much for coming on the Virtual Memory Show.
Pleasure.
And that was Glen Baxter. His new collection is Almost Completely Baxter, New and Selected Blurtings from New York Review Comics. His website, glenbaxter.com, is not working today, which bums me out. It's showing up as non-existent, and I'm not sure why, because it was working just fine a few weeks ago when I was doing research for this. Anyway, I'm hoping it's something that's easily fixable, and that you can go to glenbaxter.com to find out more about Glenn and his work. And it's spelled G-L-E-N. Baxter. So it's Glenn with one N. Now, after the main conversation, I asked Glenn, so, who are you reading? If you want to hear his answer to that, you'll need to become a supporter of the Virtual Memories show so you can get access to our monthly bonus podcast, Fear of a Square Planet. You can do that at patreon.com/VMSpod or at paypal.me/VMSpod. I've got all sorts of goals and goodies in place for supporters of the show, including that podcast, patron-only blog, a series of ebooks that I really want to launch if you guys can get me over a certain dollar amount, and more. So go to patreon.com/VMSpod and support the art of fine conversation. Now, this episode was recorded during the Small Press Expo in Bethesda, Maryland, in Glenn's hotel room. The travel costs for that trip were covered by my company because I had meetings in Washington on either side of it, but the hotel was out of pocket for me, and that added up to about $400 or so. So if you want to help defray some of my costs, visit patreon.com/VMSpod or paypal.me/VMSpod and make a one-time or recurring donation. And to the very few of you who don't like to use either of those systems, you can contact me through the website and I will give you a mailing address where you can actually send a check or buy an Amazon gift card or whatever you'd like to do. The special thanks go out to Paul W. Jones, Michael Janizek, Fred Kish, Jonathan Kranz, Andrew Mason, Greg Tanner, Zach Martin, Craig P. Steffen, and Ron Slate for going over and above in their support of the Virtual Memories show. We've got the full list of show supporters at chimeraobscura.com/VM. Now, our music for this episode is Nothing's Gonna Bring Me Down by David Bayerwald, used with permission from the artist. David's got a reunion project going with his great 80s band, David and David. You can find out more and support that at facebook.com/DavidandDavidMusic. David's also a past guest of the show, and that was a really fun episode. If you go into our archives, look up Bayerwald, which is B-A-E-R-W-A-L-D, and you can find that one. And that's it for this week's Virtual Memories show. Thanks so much for listening. I'll be back next week with the great New Yorker cartoonist and women's rights activist, Liza Donnelly. Until next time, you can subscribe to the show and download past episodes at the iTunes Store. You can also find all our episodes and get on our email list at either of our websites, vmspod.com or chimeraobscura.com/vm. You can also follow the Virtual Memories show on Twitter at vmspod, on Facebook at facebook.com/virtualmemoriesshow, and at virtualmemoriespodcast.tumblr.com. And if you like this show, please go to iTunes, look up the Virtual Memories show, and leave a rating and review for this podcast. That'll help us build a bigger audience. Until next time, you've been listening to the Virtual Memories show. I'm your host, Gil Roth, and you are awesome. Keep it that way.